There's some things that are just intrinsic to buildings that make it to where automating and connecting everything don't work. Like, one of the big things is, like, why can't we make buildings the way Tesla makes cars, right? Tesla automated the heck out of making these cars. And, you know, robots do all this assembly. It's absolutely beautiful. They automated the line so that, you know, it can make this car today and make a different type of car tomorrow. You know, like, it's really impressive. Well, one of the big reasons why we can't make buildings the way we make cars is cars are a mass-produced item that's made entirely from custom parts, right? Like, the doors for a Tesla don't fit on my Subaru. They don't fit on my Prius. Like, the doors for a Tesla are just for a Tesla. Like, they're all custom-made parts for a mass-produced item, right? Buildings are the opposite, right? It's a totally custom item that's made almost entirely from mass-produced parts, right? So those are all those pieces are just, that's just timber that you can buy from a lumber yard. Those straps and stuff are off-the-shelf items, or they were just, like, welded up at a shop somewhere. You know, buildings are 90% just off-the-shelf stuff, you know, that's minimally modified, if modified at all, and just put together into a totally custom one-off thing. Part of that is because of this. So buildings are a result of a lot of different forces coming together at the same time, okay? So you have cultural things that are happening, right? Where a building that, you know, looks like a hospital here in the Bay Area would not fly in Philadelphia, right? Like, Philadelphia expects a hospital to look different. Just culturally, local culture is a big issue. There's also political issues, right? Like, you know, trying to build on the San Francisco waterfront or trying to build in Oakland or different areas. There's local codes and local government things that you have to deal with. Economics impacts areas. Like, what's viable to build here in California, you would cost twice as much to build somewhere else, just, or take twice as much to heat, you know, with the performance issue. Like, if you build a typical California house and you put it in the Arizona desert like they did in Phoenix, now you're paying hundreds of dollars in cooling bills every summer because you had your giant picture window that looked out at your swimming pool, which is a terrible idea to have in Arizona, but hey, you know. Every building is this, like, weird combination of hyper-local issues, right? And so it's almost impossible to think that we could, like, crank out mass-produced buildings that would fit, because everybody would want it customized and edited for their specific spot. Also, the construction industry kind of works at its own time scale, right? This is from Stuart Brand's talk that was here just a little while ago. Who was here at that talk? It was great. Oh, cool. So this idea of pace layers, and these layers move at different speeds, right? So we're mostly in that infrastructure layer, right? The building industry is the last to adopt new technology, and that's not always because they're stingy or, like, because they're scared of new technology. Not to call you out, Dylan, but architect friend of mine here, how long did you work on the Stanford project that you worked on?
Only about 3 years.
But how long did the project go for? It was like
4 or 5 years.
4 or 5 years, right. So think of how much technology has changed in 5 years when it comes to, like, these things, right? There's hospital projects that are 15, 20 years in the making, right? By the time the project is done, whatever CAD system you're using for the project won't run on modern operating systems anymore. And yet you're contractually obliged by the contract to deliver the CAD files in that format. So you're running, like, virtualized systems that are running old OSs to be able to run old CAD systems to be able to, it gets ugly fast. But also really big contractors, really big builders, really big developers, they're really just risk and resource managers, right? The really big contractors that are building those hospitals or building the skyscrapers in downtown San Francisco, they might not even have a single person on their staff that actually does physical construction. They're almost finance companies at that point, where they're, and there's literally, like, some of the larger contractors have people working for them that are almost like hedge fund managers that are buying steel futures. So 7 years from now, when you buy the steel to build your hospital, it's hedged in case steel doubles in price in that 7 years, right? So they're very risk averse. So unless they know that a technology is gonna work, they don't really go into it. But then also, weirdly enough, part of the building industry works at that top layer too, right? Where there's last minute changes for a variety of reasons. Planning around certain things can be really difficult. Like, hospital projects have to, most hospital projects, because they take 5 to 7 years to build, by the time the project is done, the MRI machines that they plan to have in the hospital are totally outdated now. So they purposely plan to be able to just, okay, in 7 years from now, when they actually buy the real machine, it has to fit in the room that we designed 7 years ago. You know, so there's all this crazy stuff that happens. So the time scale, too, is something that lends itself to where it's very difficult for us to mass produce buildings, you know, in the way that we build cars.